Hi guys, welcome to another round of Chitter Chatter. Today we are going to chit chat with author Shibu and we are going to talk about his book Faith and Beloved. Well, let me tell you a little about the book. The book is all about a mystery novel. Well, it has a lot of plots and many more characters. It's going to keep you hooked and grooved. But you need lots of cup of coffees and you need to have a lot of dedication to read this one, because you are going to be continuously discovering many twists and turns. And I'm going to send author the request and get started with our show. Hopefully, this time we get started. Hey, Vivek Kapoor, how are you doing? Fashion Gaga, hi. How are you doing? Feroz Khanjan. Hello, author Shibu. Welcome to Chitter Chatter.
Thank you, Shweta. Thank you.
How are you? I have spoken a lot about your book because this is literally our take three. So please, can you tell us something about your book to a beautiful viewers who have been patient and have been waiting for this chit chat?
Sure. Of course, it's what I call it's a crime thriller, and it's all about value system in life and how much you're willing to stretch yourself for your loved ones or your dear ones. That's what the whole book is about. And that's always the perspective from which it's to be read.
So tell me, you know, it has a lot of research, like as and when I read, because there's so many plots and there's so many characters involved which get linked at a different point, you know, like there are like too many of them. Though the story is particularly of four people, but there are many more people involved and, you know, different agents and all of that involved. And like I said, I'm refraining from giving a lot of information because I don't want to give spoilers. But how much time did go in to write Faith and Beloved and for the entire research?
So this book took me 2 years and 1,800 man writing hours to complete. So research and writing. So it's a fair amount of time that I spent on this.
That's a long time. Well, I have to tell you, before I started reading the book, the moment I got, I love the title, I love the cover, and it does so much justice to the entire story that is, you know, written in this book. How did you decide on this title?
The title was actually decided after writing the book, because, you know, one of the things that I do is that when you write a book, I do writing which is called character-based writing. So I write, sketch the characters first. And even if the character is minor or major, all of them will have a past and a present. So unlike the Hindi movies where you find only the hero has a past and the villain doesn't, here, you know, everyone has got a past and all of them are in shades of gray. And I leave it to the readers to decide the, you know, judgment whether who's a hero and who's a villain and what is right and what's wrong, without the author being judgmental. That's one side. The second part is, of course, that when you write the book and when you've completed, it's a book based on the fiercest terror organization that ever existed in the history of the world, which is LTTE. So when they were active, there was no limit to which they could go. And they had developed the cult of suicide terrorism, which was started by them. And they had an array of an army of people who were willing to give up their lives, including a small girl who was, you know, blow up our ex-prime minister. So very fierce organization. So the whole book, if you see, it's about value system and, you know, how different people and value what they think is their value system in life and what they're standing for. Sometimes it's a cause, sometimes because someone, you lost somebody, sometimes because you believe in something. So finally, it's about how value system plays up in your life and at times how you're put to test. Most of us, most of the times, are never put to this kind of test of your value system. But some of us, at some time, once in a life, maybe, you know, a couple of times in a life, you do face these kind of challenges. May not be to this extent, but varying degrees. So after writing the book, that's how this kind of title came naturally to me. You know, I said, okay, this is the title and it conveys what it's supposed to convey.
So like I said, you know, there are so many minor characters, there are major characters. Each one has a backstory which gets connected further through the stories. Then there is LTTE, there is ISI, there is IS. Like, there's so much. So how was your process when it came to editing it? Because you had your final plot, you knew what you're writing, the story, but I'm sure there was a lot of matter that needed to also edit. And when you're so closely connected, how was the whole editing process after writing?
So actually, the one of the things that all the editors ask for is the same question they ask for in advance, you know, on timelines, characters, who is where, what happens. So when you write the book, you have a nice, you have a kind of whiteboard where it's just a character one, this is a time, this is a place, and where the character one is, you know, important snapshots where he or she is going to be. So you capture about, there are about eight or nine, some major and some minor characters who are given details, and it's a thriller. So the events in the life of all those characters you described is linked to the main plot at some point. So it is also in many ways a challenge to the readers. If you see the blueprint of the whole book is in the first chapter, which you will realize at the end. You'll not know it then. So in the first chapter, you're given enough clues, and each of them is, you know, the three people who are chasing it, and they're seeing it in from various angles, and they know how you decipher from what information is available to you. And how, as each character goes by. So one of the, you know, let's say the expectation of the readers is that they will read it carefully, because if they do not, after they finish the fourth or fifth chapter, they'll suddenly find that they're not able to correlate.
I
They're not able
agree.
to correlate.
That was the first thing I said in my introduction, that you need to read this mystery with a lot of dedication and devotion.
Yes, I mean, maybe I'm expecting a little too much out of the readers, because it does become it for a discerning reader, okay. But if you just flip through, you'll think that, you know, that many of them have told me also the author is confused. I said, yes, I agree. So which means you have not been able to decipher the plot. So that's, you know, that's one of the challenges when you're doing a thriller book. You give a beginning. So in the beginning itself, you know that there is something which has gone wrong right in the beginning. But after that, you know, kind of sprinkle the clues along the chapters. So you know that the discerning reader knows, okay, so here is a clue, here is a clue. You can see that to those discerning readers. Then you see how the whole thing is going to get tied up, and where it's going to get tied up, and who's going to, you know, decipher it first, and things like that. So I guess, yes, it is a fair amount of work which you have to give this information to the editor. When then, you know, the editor will always ask you, okay, where is this character? What's the timeline? When was he born? So what is this date? So even though I'm not mentioning the date in the text, but the editor has to know. Then say, okay, so this is right, that is right, all right. So then the time and space calculation. So because the novel is set on a very vast spectrum, so there is geography, there is time, there is space, and there are people. So there was a kind of matrix which I had made, and on the basis of which you keep track, which is very important, very important. And I agree with what you said, it is very important.
So also LTTE at this point is something which is like kind of, you know, it's been there, but it's kind of lost its thing because lately not much has been written on those bases. But your novel has a major backdrop of it. So how did you decide on this point, like this is your major driving point and wrote your novel?
See, one of the things that, you know, I always tell, you know, this was a deliberate effort. As usual, you know, the memory of the public is quite short, and, you know, you tend to forget the events. But LTTE from for about 3 decades, from about, let's say, sometime in the 80s, early 80s, till beginning of, let's say, the 21st century, over 30 odd years, 2000, till 2007, 8, 35 years. They were very active, and there were so many things that they did. And, you know, which had repercussions of the society. So today it may not be LTTE, it may be somebody else. But the whole question is, whatever they did, and they were the ones who started this whole cycle of suicide terrorism as a way of warfare, so which others have caught on and public, you know, following. So the LTTE had close associations with all the other terror organizations in the world. So it's also to kind of enlighten our people to say, this is what happened at that time. LTTE is not there, but what they did have not gone away. There are others who will do the same thing to you, worse or maybe better, but to be seen. So this was a kind of way of sensitizing and to people to what happened, you know, in our history, in Indian history in recent times, why things went wrong, why, you know, and what people do when, you know, things go wrong in life. So this is in many ways to, you know, recap, and that's one of the things I do in all my books. It's so always a perspective on history, which I believe you should have as readers, and you should not be kind of toeing the line for one television channel or a newspaper and not knowing where the truth lies. And truth always is never either with one newspaper or one TV channel. It's always somewhere in between. So that is, it's again one of the ways to sensitize the readers to get them to understand, okay, so where does the truth lie and what is the perspective on this? So while the novel is fiction, the background is highly real.
And
So
you know, like,
people should know.
Of hours and years that you've given, the dedication you had while writing this novel. So tell me, what is the advice that you want to give the writers out there? Because you know, you've written two novels, both have been really highly appreciated. So what's your advice for the new writers out there?
I just tell them always, you know, that it's, writing is all about power of observation. So when people read the novel and tell you the characters look, is it copied from somebody? No, it is not. Inspired, yes. But so when the readers feel that the characters are alive, which also means that, okay, you have succeeded in creating a character. So there's a lot of observation of people and observation of events that take place. And there's a phenomenal amount of effort which goes into that to make that observation very realistic as much as you can. So when you write about recent events in the history, whether it is demonetization, whether it is, let's say, the terror attack in Mumbai, or whether it is a little slightly older problem of the ongoing, the you know, never-ending problem of caste and the caste-related issues in the country. And some of the issues, what you say, you know, the issue may be related to people who are, you know, caste violent in some village somewhere, but it takes out, it is taken out in some form against, you know, women who have nothing to do with this in Bombay or Delhi. But then it's a reflection of, you know, suppressed, let's say, anger, suppressed emotion. So one of the messages is also about, you know, to say that, you know, it's an issue which we need to address. There is no way of trying to brush it away, because it will keep coming. You know, unfortunately for us, the caste system has not, you know, been very dominant in our cities, in our urban life. But still, the people who come, their problems always spill over. It gets carried forward into their life. Some of it knowingly, some of it by design. So that is a perspective on this whole thing. So to the writers, all I say is that always observe and write. India is a country of billion people. There are billion stories out there, not dearth of stories.
You know, you have been an award-winning author and you've written a best-selling book, Men and Dreams and All Others. And then writing your second book. So, you know, was there a pressure to, you know, recreate again as much success while you were writing already?
So the first book was actually, it's more of the traditional classical style of writing with a little bit of thriller thrown in. So that was more in the line of, let's say, the Booker Prize writing. And the first book took me 4 years in research. So there's a lot of detailing about culture and lifestyle of people. And it was focused on the life of hydroelectric project workers in a project site, a kind of detailing which you never get to read from any author who writes fiction. It's because it takes a lot of effort. So the first book was a completely different kind. It was, you know, written in that Booker Prize kind of style of writing. Let me put it that way. So that the targeting was in that line. But this is a, let's say, it's called a crime thriller. It is as a thriller. But what I believe in is that, you know, even when you're reading a thriller or fiction, there is a certain amount of value addition to the readers, which I believe in giving. So when I started writing my first book in 2009, I stopped reading fiction. So I've not been reading fiction for almost 12 years now. It's a handicap in the sense that you're not really current on what's happening books, but that's a price which I'm willing to pay to maintain individuality and develop a style of writing which is your own. So first book was mostly a classic and with, you know, a little bit of technical fiction and, you know, thriller in the background. Second one is mostly a thriller, but again with a little bit of classical writing in between. So I guess, you know, the third book will also be a little different. That is what I said, you know, after the third one, then I'll decide to stabilize on whichever one I think is the best.
Oh, that was my next question. That is this going to be, is Faith and Beloved going to continue, or is this going to be a standalone?
No, Faith and Beloved, of course, it's a crime thriller, it'll be a standalone crime thriller. So the next book will have a mixture of something I've not really, you know, many stories churning in my mind. But I'm yet to decide what it's going to be. Or which one it's going to be, not what.
A part of the book, which was the most difficult part for you to write?
Let me put it this way, that, you know, I call the word I use is challenging. So writing comes with a lot of challenges. But I enjoy the challenges in the sense that, you know, you may write, let's say, for example, if I'm writing about war-torn Sri Lanka of 2007. Now, I've been to Sri Lanka in 2003. I've been there before. But when I write about war torn Sri Lanka in 2007, so even for, you know, you may write a page or a paragraph that you want that, you know, that should be authentic. So it takes again time and effort to speak to people to get your sure that when you write, when someone reads it, someone who's been there in that time and that period should know, okay, this is how it was, this book is talking how it was. Or as the book starts with, let's say, the 1930s. So when you write about 1930s, you do need to kind of, you know, find that, do a lot of research, speak to people to know that when you give a flavor of 1930s, it is a flavor of 1930s and what you're writing. Or even recent, more recent things like, you know, that bomb Mumbai terror attack, or let's say the demonetization, a different perspective on things. And then, of course, all of this has to be with, you know, information which is available in the open domain. That is also, that is, you know, that so that you're not, many of the areas are sometimes sensitive, so you have to be careful on what you write. So to that extent, yes, you know, when you put all this together and come up with the whole lot of things, so there's a phenomenal amount of research in every aspect. So one of the things what I say is, you have got one protagonist, or let's say the two lady protagonists. One is IIT, IIM, you know, from the rich family, and they're on the top of the society and running a business. So that's one type of character. So there's a background of IIT, IIM, and, you know, the Lovedale schools and that kind of stuff, one side. Then the two brothers who are from that, you know, in the heartland and, you know, back home from that caste oppressed society. And it's a completely other end of the spectrum. Right. So when you write about these people, the range of writing is quite a bit. Then you introduce characters, somebody who's a driver, somebody who's something else, and you've got an LTT product who is in a product of that time, and then he's gone to Canada and come back. So when you write a novel with the spread of characters which, you know, go from bottom end to top end and in between, and then of course there are so many things which happen, and not everything is right, many wrong things happening. So there have been many challenges with each. I would say the challenges were there in actually character sketching of each of those characters. But I like the challenge because, you know, it takes a fair amount of research and reading before you can get into the shoes of the character. So when you write, you feel that, okay, now I got it. So I'm writing, then you have to write nonstop till you get out of the shoes and get into the character. So I will not say difficulties. I will say that it is challenges, but then that's what the whole beauty of the whole thing is.
So while you had the challenges coming your way and you have been successful overcoming all those challenges, the entire process of writing, was it exhausting or was it energizing?
Energizing and challenging. Exhausting, no, never. See, because when you write, you know, that one of the things about writing is you have characters and you reach about 3-4 chapters. And at some point, the whole story and all the characters are clear in your mind.
Right.
In my first book, it took me about 2 years before that happened. You know, till then, I used to have a board and a checklist to see who is where and all that. In this case, it took me about 6 months. And by the time I was 6 months into the novel, yes, yeah, I knew where the character. So the whole story is playing in your mind like a movie. So unless you get that, it's very difficult to get a grip on that. And once you get that, it's, then, you know, it's your, you sit down, you every day when you sit down to start writing, and, you know, okay, just close your eyes and, you know, okay, you got, you know, where your characters were, then you move forward. So the, if you want to reach that stage, then it is energizing and charming. But the first part till you reach there, yes, it is quite challenging and diligent work, wherein you have to maintain a checklist, you have to see who is where, what time, what's happening, have you messed up somewhere. So it's, in many ways, it's like getting the whole story in your mind. I mean, that's, then only it'll flow well. You must get into the flow of writing. And when you got your whole plot and story in your mind, clearly.
So while I was diligently cruising through your novel, I had my favorite character, Alice. I want to know, who's your favorite character?
So, you know, I have been asked this question. I said, you know, I have spent as much effort in trying to create each of those characters. All of them are dear to me. So I'll leave it to the readers to decide who they think is, you know, favorite. I have no favorite.
If you were biased towards somebody, who would it be?
That's an unfair question. That'll be an unfair answer because, you know, I'm just telling you, as a writer, each of those characters, there's so much effort and time that you get into to get into. Let's say I'm talking about a small guy who's a driver, come up, you know, part-time criminal.
Yeah.
No, just to create that character, you spend as much time as researching and writing about Alexander, you know, the stories of that side, or, you know, about Nethi and the life in the IIM and the IIT. So the because your efforts involved in creating a character, that not it is not really related to their relevance of the story. So when you put so much effort, so many people ask me also, why do you give so much background of so many characters? Because I said, I do not want to leave them like Hindi movies where, you know, you feel that, you know, the director decided he's a hero, he's a villain. I said, I don't want to decide like that. I said, I'll leave the readers decide. They're all in shades of gray. It's up to you to decide who is a hero and who's a heroine.
So there are many quotes also in the book which actually move you. Quotes from Bhagavad Gita, quotes from what one character is telling the other. And one of my favorite quotes, "Soul, if you want to learn the secrets, your heart must forget about shame and dignity. You are God's lover, yet you worry about what people are saying." It's a quote which I really loved from your book, and I really resonated with it. Is there any particular quote that you love from your book? Though all the words must be very special for you, but any particular quote that you would like to quote?
Okay. See, when it comes to quotes, actually, again, you know, that, you know, each chapter and each character, I have tried to kind of philosophize and give that, you know, quote which resonates with that character in that stage of the story or the thought process of the character when you're going through challenging times. Very often what happens is that, you know, like in the first chapter itself, you know, when the degree to which a person has to go take someone's life, no, it's not easy. So like, you know, in your social norms, it's called crossing the barriers. So there comes a time when you believe that this is, you know that you're crossing the line, but you feel that that is possibly lesser of the evils than not crossing the line. There comes a time when you have to do it. So there is always, you cannot do this unless your mind is tempered to do it. And tempering of the mind comes with a certain amount of philosophy and certain amount of understanding, depending on whichever source you draw it from. So to that extent, you know, I would say that each of those quotes are dear to me. I really don't know which one to pick it on.
I knew this is coming, and that's why I said I know every quote is special. Every word is special for you writing the novel, but I am not going to let you excuse this time. You will have to quote me something from your book.
Okay. So let's say, I mean, even as a simple quote like this, you know, it's like this. If you do it, don't be afraid. If you're afraid, don't do it. Okay, now this is something which I believe applies to all of us at every stage in life.
Absolutely.
In every aspect of life. So if you just want to say something which, you know, it may not be very philosophical in that sense, but I believe it's something which is very practical, which is said by Desai in one of his quotes, in that when you speak to the design team. Now that is equally not only design team, it's equal to the, you know, the acting world, it is acting to the creative world, writing world. So, because one of the reasons why I said this is, you know, when you write, because, you know, many people have told me this, saying that you have crossed a moral compass in, you know, the place. So what I told them is one of the challenges which an author has got is when you create a background and you create a scenario and you get into the shoes of a character and you're writing. Now, and that, when you're writing, you have to be clear in your mind and you have to be confident of what you're doing. There's two things are required: clarity and confidence. Once you have these two, then you write. I mean, that time you can't be thinking this is the line of this compass, that is the line. Then your complete writing will be, you know, artificial. So that is, you know, where the editor comes in and, you know, editor says, okay, cut here, cut there. Wherever he or she feels that, you know, you're cross the line, they cut you and say, okay, or your biases have come inside. So to that part, yes. So when you get so much into detailing and so much into writing like this, you know, the getting into characters, philosophizing, and giving them a perspective, which is what I believe. Finally, it is not meant in any way to offend anybody, or it's a fiction novel. So where the background may be real, events are fictional. They're not events which have happened. So this be taken in that spirit.
See, you've got mixed reviews. There are some people who are saying that, you know, you've crossed barriers, there is a moral compass, and then you need dedication, devotion. Then there are some people who are in all of it. What is your most favorite compliment that you've received? And which are a few which you were like trying to justify the critics?
No, the first part is, let me clear this. You know, I always tell the people, you know, say, love my book, hate my book, don't ignore it. Okay. So if someone says I love the book, I'm okay. Someone says I hate the book, I'm okay with that also. But someone if you say so-so, then I'm worried. Truly worried. If someone says, oh, yeah, so-so, then it's, you know, that's a terrible thing. Then you know, something is seriously wrong. So I always believe the reader is a king and the queen. And all books cannot, this is not a Bhagavad Gita or a Quran or a Bible or something that everybody has to like it. No. It is a fiction novel and I'm sure, you know, it is not meant for everybody to like. And there are, you know, about 20% of the people have disliked it and disliked it very seriously. You know, they have said in as many words, almost short of saying that, you know, this book should be banned. They have said everything. But the other 80%, so I keep telling this, it is meant for, let's say, the mature adult reader. Because the two, three issues, see, today, unfortunately for us, the English reading audience of our country are what I call, they're relatively affluent and almost insulated from the rough and tumble of the society. So the English novel reading crowd, most of them are not really, you know, maybe privy to their concept of rough and tumble of the world is what you see on which channel and, you know, mostly related to TV channel and drawing room kind of understanding that unless somebody is a journalist or somebody is actually in working in a field, in a particular field, very exposed to it. Otherwise, majority of them are insulated from this. So let's say when you talk about an event, let's say, for example, Nirbhaya case, everyone agrees, even I agree, it should not have happened, 100%. But if you say because it happened, someone writes about it that you are saying that, you know, you're justifying it, no. So an event like this should not have happened. And let's say the most vicious one was a teenager and was let go because the law says it should be 18, which I said, I would also agree. There were people who said that you should have been given the same punishment and the rest. I agree with them. Should have been. So there are so many aspects which are far beyond the book to say that people may not even like this, what I'm telling now. Say, the legal system that we adopted is from the British. And it is meant for a very affluent and educated society.
Right.
Now, in our case, we are neither affluent nor educated enough. We are not affluent enough nor educated enough. Though the average man of the country is, let's say, 1/10 of what, let's say, an average man of a British citizen is in terms of his lifestyle, in terms of his expectations. So what happens is that if you're in a country where, you know, going to jail means getting 3 times meal a day and that seems to be an attraction, no, your legal system has its limitations. So in your previous, let's say, the system that we have followed, let's say, people do not like khap panchayats because khap panchayats are very brutal, very, very brutal when it comes to their, the kind of the judgments they give and the punishments they mete out. But then that is also reality. It's only that kind of punishment which keeps the people in check.
Right.
You may not like the moral compass that they're using, social moral compass, but the dealing out of punishments is related to what they think will keep that community in check or the people in check. So there is a kind of disconnect between, let's say, what the legal system works for majority of the people, but it may not work for all the people at all the time. So, I mean, these are all larger questions which cannot be answered in a fiction novel, but the idea is to kind of throw up the thought process to know, to get people thinking. So that's why I say, you know, so I am very happy with reviews, both positive and negative. But I hate, the only thing I hate is if someone says, yeah, so. Then I feel terrible. Thankfully for me, there have not been many like that. A handful of them, maybe an odd one here, there. But mostly the people have liked it or disliked it. So both are okay with me.
So viewers, whether you like it or dislike it, go get a copy of Faith and Beloved. Read it. And whether you liked, disliked, please do let authors know. Don't let us know so. We want either a like or a dislike and a genuine review. So when you read it, do DM the author and let him know how you've liked it or how you've disliked it. The choice is yours. But do get a copy and do read it. Do you have your copy around so that we can take a selfie?
Are you asking me?
Yes. Do you have your copy around so that we can take a selfie?
Is this one?
Yes, 1 second. I shall take a selfie right now. Smile, please.
Okay.
Okay, we have our selfie moment with the author. Now, we're going to play a quick question-answer round, which is more like a rapid fire. So, just to know a little more about you as a reader, as a writer. So, are you ready for this rapid fire round?
Sure.
So, which is the book you're currently reading?
I have stopped reading fiction since 2009, so I'm not reading fiction.
But
yes,
anyhow,
I am reading. No, I read technical books at this point, research and background. So if you should know what is a technical book, The Laws of Physics is the latest one which is on my table. I thought I was
the fictional book you last read.
The fictional book. White Tiger.
A book adaptation that you really liked on the screen.
Oh, book adaptation that you write on the screen. The Shawshank Redemption.
If you had to adapt your book, who are the characters you would love to see on screen playing your characters?
I would prefer if they would give fresh faces and not any existing face.
Wow, that's a rare thing. Usually I never get the chance. I wish I could highlight this.
No, serious. Because I believe this, one of the things that I believe in is that, you know, see, this book is written very differently and does not fit into the typical, you know, the, let's say, the character sketching of our Bollywood or any of the channels existing. So if at all, someday if it is made, I would, of course, would look for that. The all characters should be fresh faces and not pre-existing ones.
What time of the day you love to read?
Oh, any time of the day. Reading is like, for me, anytime. Starting from morning till night, reading is kind of part of my life. It's just that I've stopped fiction reading, but I do read. I mean, like, without reading, you cannot survive. Writing is your lifeline.
What time of the day you like to write?
Normally, in the towards the evenings. Normally, 7 to 10 is the preferred time.
What is your favorite snack while reading?
Sorry, while reading or writing?
While reading.
Reading is tea.
What Spice do you tea. Do besides reading and writing?
Yoga.
If you had to give another title to Faith and Beloved, what would it be?
The advertisement where? On which platform?
Any platform. It could be a digital one.
Okay, digital one will be the best-selling and award-winning novel by the author. Please read. It's a riveting saga of love, lust, and you know, intrigue.
One mantra of your life.
The harder you work, the luckier you seem.
And one line if you had to tell all your readers out here.
Sorry, please repeat that.
If you had to tell all your readers out here a message, what would it be?
Please take a time out and read.
And how was it, Chitter Chatter with Shweta Rohira?
Thank you so much. It's great.
Thank you, author, for your time and for the chit chat. It was lovely having you here. And we are looking forward for many more books from you. And wish you happy reading and happy writing.
Thank you so much, Shweta. And thank you all the readers who are watching this. Thank you so much.
Guys, we are signing out. Thank you for your time on Chitter Chatter. In case you missed any of the chat, our Chitter Chatter is going to be on IGTV. So you can watch it. You can also tag your friends to watch it. And if you have not read the book, then you know what to do right now. Go online and grab your copy of Faith and Beloved. Thank you, everyone. Yeah.